Good afternoon. Thanks for coming to this seminar. So today I will explain a case of induced seismicity that most likely all of you know is the case of the underground gas storage of Castor, which occurred 9 years ago in the offshore in the Spanish coast. And it caused a lot of public concern because the local population were feeling the earthquakes, and eventually the project was cancelled with a lot of investment compensation for the company that we pay with the taxes. And one of the main messages that I want to convey today is that usually or traditionally induced seismicity has been considered to be triggered by pore pressure diffusion, so due to the injection pressure changes or increases, and this brings the stress of state to failure conditions. But we will see today that in most cases, and in particular in Castor, there are other processes that may trigger seismicity, and we should take them into account in order to make good estimates. So these three numbers are the main characteristics of Castor. The 3.1 refers to the maximum magnitude of the earthquakes. There were three earthquakes above magnitude 4, and these three earthquakes represent the largest earthquakes ever induced in any underground gas storage. So quite particular this case. Then 17 are the days after the stop of injection at which the largest events were induced. And we should take into account that the injection lasted for 15 days. So usually, as you know, in hydrogeology, if we inject for 15 days, after 15 days after the stop of injection, one would expect that pore pressure is negligible. So in this case, after 17 days, pore pressure was already negligible and quite minor. So there must be something else during the earthquake. And 4 to 10 are the kilometers below the surface where the seismicity was induced. And you should take into account that the injection was, the gas was injected at 1.7 kilometers deep. So the largest events were occurring much deeper than the injection interval. So a brief overview of Castor. Castor was a project that was envisioned strategic for gas storage in Spain. The idea was that Castor at its maximum capacity could store the gas that is consumed during 50 days in the whole Spain. So really a big reserve that could be useful for situation in which there are conflicts like right now in Ukraine, in which the price of the gas or the availability of the gas is compromised, and having a big storage of the gas can help to provide to guarantee the supply to the population. So as you can see, it is offshore, and there are several faults in the Valencia throat, which are seismically active. So this region of the Mediterranean is still extensioning. It suffers some extension, and this from time to time induces some seismicity, sometimes with magnitudes up to five. And as you can see, Castor was injecting next to the Amposta fault, which is one of these active faults. So here you can see a cross section. This is the Amposta fault, which was bonding the storage formation, and they were injecting here. It's a carbonate rock which used to produce oil in the 70s and 80s, and they were producing heavy oil, so they knew that this reservoir had a good cap for the gas, and this is why they selected the site. And you can see that the company had a very good knowledge of the subsurface. They did a lot of monitoring and a lot of characterization, and they knew the faults in the around the reservoir. Actually, they invested more than 1,000 million, so more than 1 billion euros in characterization and development of the site. And in particular, they drilled 14 wells. Ten they were for injection production and for monitoring, or the other way around. Then the sequence of the events worked like this. They started injecting cushion gas for 15 days in early September 2013. And after a few days, the number of earthquakes per day was increasing, as well as the magnitude. And eventually the people started feeling the earthquakes and there was some pressure, and they decided to stop the activity. Then the pore pressure, the seismic activity decreased a bit, but after these 17 days, there was a peak in activity, both in magnitude and in frequency. And you can see that the accumulative moment magnitude was concentrated in these days. So there was a lot of public demonstration asking for the stop of the project, and eventually the project was canceled and the investment compensation was of close to 5 billion euros, which is really a huge amount that we will have to pay using for 30 years. So let's start by seeing how seismicity is induced. So imagine we have a fracture in the subsurface. That is the tectonic stresses that tend to close the fracture, and eventually, so acting on the fault, we have this normal stress that tends to close the fault. But as we go deep, the fractures are saturated, so they contain fluids that have a pore pressure. And this pore pressure tends to open the fracture. So actually what is closing the fracture is the normal effective stress. And due to the tectonic stresses, we also have a shear stress that tends to produce a shear slip of the fracture. So the fracture will be stable as long as the tangential forces are lower than the friction coefficient times the effective normal stress. So if we look to the Mohr cycle, which represents the stress of a state, initially we are in a stable situation. This is the failure surface. And as long as our Mohr cycle is far from the failure surface, we are in a stable situation. If we touch the failure surface, there will be an earthquake. So then we start injecting, and this injection increases the pore pressure and also induces stress changes due to the pore mechanical response of the rock. And eventually we are approaching failure conditions. And if we keep injecting, eventually we may reach failure conditions. And if this happens, we will induce an earthquake. There will be a shear of the fracture, and the elastic energy that is released will induce the seismic waves that we can feel on the surface if the magnitude is high enough. So we have seen that there are basically two factors controlling induced seismicity. One is the stress of a state, and the other one is the pore pressure changes. So let's take a look to the stress of a state at Castor. Despite the fact that, as I was mentioning, they drill 14 wells, the stress of a state is not reported at Castor. I guess they have measurements, but they have not been made public. So we had to work with we had to look to nearby well bores. In this region, there are some reservoirs that contain oil, so there are some wells and we have two nearby wells separated a few tens of kilometers from Castor, and we were taking the stress of a state measure with breakouts in these wells. So here you can see the estimates of this stress of a state, which in the region is considered to be normal faulting with a strike slip. it's a combination. This means that the vertical stress equals the maximum horizontal stress, and then we have a horizontal stress that is lower than this two. And the orientations are like this. This is the maximum horizontal stress, which is more or less equal to the vertical one, and the minimum horizontal stress is perpendicular to the coast. As we were saying before, the Mediterranean is extending, so this is why in this direction of extension there is the minimum horizontal stress. And the other thing that we know is that the stress of the state is critically stressed because this is a seismic area, and from time to time there are some earthquakes. So if we do a slip tendency analysis with this stress of the state and we locate the amposta fault in it, we see that it falls in the critically stressed region, which is this with red, dark red colors. These values of 0.6 means that the faults in this region are critically stressed, are close to the friction coefficient, which is usually in rocks, in fractures, is usually 0.6. So for a small perturbations of these faults, we may reactivate them. And then the other factor that controls induced seismicity is pore pressure changes. And in this case, the reservoir is castified and the permeability is very large. It's higher than 10 to the minus 12 meter square. And actually the pore pressure that was reported by the company was of 0.8 MPa. So not really a big overpressure. And as I was mentioning before, the largest events occurred 17 days after the stop of injection. So at that time, the pore pressure changes were negligible. So if pore pressure changes are negligible and we know that the amposta fault is critical stress, what we may think is that shear slip stress transfer was inducing the sequence of earthquakes. So if one fault is reactivated, like this one, that is a slip, there will be a pressure drop around the area that slips, but then some regions, the ones in red, are destabilized. And if there are faults in this region or even the same fault in other locations, maybe destabilized and induce more and more effort. And so initially we worked with this hypothesis, and we will see what happened. So the other thing that we need to know is the location of the earthquake. Fortunately, there was a very poor monitoring in the area. The Observatory de l'Ebre, they asked to place seismometers in the seafloor, and actually they installed two, but they were not working, so they have been useless. And this has made the interpretation of the induced seismicity very complicated, because there are only seismometers on the coast and it's difficult to triangulate since there are no any arrival signal on the other side of the platform. There is only on one side, and this difficults making a precise location of the induced earthquake. And nonetheless, both the location and especially the depth depends a lot on the velocity model that is chosen for the seismic waves. And what has been found is that in all cases, the depth of the earthquakes is calculated to be below the reservoir. So the reservoir is at 1.7 kilometers, and depending on the velocity model that is chosen, can be more or less deep, but in all cases it's always deeper than the storage formation. So the faults that were inducing the largest earthquakes are not in the reservoir, but significantly deep. So the first interpretation of the seismicity was the one provided by Simone Cesca in 2014, and they were providing two focal mechanisms One was a vertical plane, this one, and this one was a subhorizontal plane. And when we do the slip tendency analysis, we see that the vertical plane is very, very stable, so it's unlikely to fail. And the other one, the subhorizontal, is also far from this critical stress region. So the only way of reactivating this force would be with a very high pressure. Actually, we were calculating and it was needed at least 10 MPa overpressure, which is 10 times the overpressure that was reported. So in principle, quite unlikely. And nonetheless, we performed the shear stress transfer analysis. So we were following the sequence of pools that were reactivated and seeing how the stresses were changing. And so the blue colors are stable, is a stable situation, and red color is unstable situation. Just for you to see the trace of the faults, and you can see that is these red lines. The slip of explain this sequence of earthquakes with the shear slip stress transfer for the case of Cheska. So for a while we couldn't really explain the seismicity, but then the Senor Tor in 2020, they provided a new interpretation of the seismicity. And in this case, one of the nodal planes was quite a steep plane. And the location of these earthquakes was quite well aligned with one of these nodal planes. So this means that most likely there was a deep fault following this orientation that was not known at that time, but that was inducing this large seismicity, and this fault was located in the crystalline basement, which is stiffer, and this is why it releases more energy when it fails. So we knew that the Amposta fault was critically stressed, and with the interpretation of Villaseñor, we knew that there was a deep fault that was inducing the earthquake. However, we still don't know how to explain the link, right? We were injecting at 1.7 kilometers. How could this injection induce the seismicity between 4 to 10 kilometers deep without any hydraulic connection, right? So this was quite intriguing, and we will see what explanation we provided. So the first triggering mechanism that we found that was acting was buoyancy. So the injected gas at the pressure and temperature conditions of the storage formation had a density of around 100 kilos per cubic meter, but the resident brine, which is seawater, has a density higher than 1,000 kilograms per cubic meter. So the difference in density is very high, 900 kilograms per cubic meter, and this exerts really a vertical force, a buoyancy force, that is pushing the whole reservoir upwards. And this induces changes in the stress. So above the storage formation, the vertical stress increases because of this buoyancy force that pushes the rock upwards. And there is also a horizontal unloading to satisfy the stress balance. So if initially we are in this black line, this stress of state, due to these changes above the reservoir, we get a higher deviatoric stress, which brings us to failure conditions. And then, well, and below the reservoir is the way around, stability increased. But this means that the Amposta fault, which was almost critical, it was a critical stress, so for a small perturbation with its failure, with this instability, we start inducing a slip of the of the Amposta Fault. And the Amposta Fault is a very mature fault. It has accumulated 1 kilometer of slip, so it has been sleeping for a long time. And this makes that the fault behaves in a ductile way. So when it deforms, it does it seismically, slowly, but without inducing large earthquakes, because it has a lot of clay in the core, and it doesn't fail in a brittle way. So this buoyancy was accumulating a seismic slip of the Amposta Fault. And then what we did was to calculate the shear slip stress transfer, considering that the Amposta Fault was slipping. And we knew that the first large earthquake in the sequence was placed at 9 kilometers deep. This is the nodal plane. So we were computing the Coulomb failure stress, which tell us if we have positive values, is that we have failure conditions. And if we have negative values, we are in a stable situation. So we computed using Okada solution, which is an analytical solution to compute the shear stress transfer. What was the slip and area of the Amposta Fault that had to slip seismically in order to reactivate this fault? And what we found is that it should be reactivated from the reservoir, a little bit above the reservoir, down to 3.5 kilometers or close to 4 kilometers deep. And this slip actually induces failure conditions below the reservoir. And we also performed hydromechanical simulations of the gas injection here in the storage formation. And when we were computing the changes in the Coulomb failure stress, the positive values means that we approach failure, we see that all this area is under failure conditions, which corresponds with our analysis with the analytical solution of Okada. So both the analytical solution and the numerical model give us similar results, and this gave us confidence that actually the Amposta Fault was sleeping in all this length. So these stress changes were inducing the first earthquake, and then once we have the first earthquake, there is a slip, and this slip is inducing further stress changes. So what we did was to analyze the whole sequence, earthquake by earthquakes, and seeing if the slip of the first earthquake was inducing failure condition on the second one, and so on. And actually, we see that the second earthquake is in the positive colors, so it's yellow and red colors. The same for the third one, the fourth one, and so on until the last one. So with this shear slip stress transfer, we can explain the sequence of earthquakes. But what is missing was the explanation of what is causing the delay between the earthquakes. And for this, we performed numerical simulations using Colebrite, in which we were imposing a slip. So here you can see the slip that we were imposing in the fault with this direction. And this causes some tension here, compression here. And when we have the compression, this area and this area, we have an increase of the pore pressure. You can see that in a granite, which is very stiff, these pore pressure changes can be large, up to 30 MPa, so much higher than the changes in pore pressure induced by the gas injection. And in the regions where we have extensions, so here and here, we have a pressure drop. So what we found is that there are some regions. So here again, we have the fault that has slipped, and we have some regions where stability decreases. But due to this pore pressure decrease, if we look to the evolution in time with the stability, the pore pressure drop causes a temporal improvement of the stability, but once the pore pressure diffuses, eventually we reach failure conditions, and this may be inducing further earthquake. So this was our explanation for the temporal evolution of the sequence. So overall, we see that there are several triggering mechanisms that are in general involved in induced seismicity. So we have seen the case of Castor, there was quite a number of triggering mechanisms, but in general, we will have more than just pressure built up, and it's important to consider this other triggering mechanism. So apart from pressure built up, in Castor we have buoyancy, and this will also affect in cases where we inject gases that are lighter than the resident water. Cooling is also very important, especially in the long term, as the volume of cooled rock becomes larger, because usually the fluids that are injected are colder than the initial temperature of the rock. And as we inject more and more fluid, the region that is cooled down increases in size. And cooling induces a thermal stress reduction that eventually may reach failure conditions. And then we have the shear stress transfer. So when there is an earthquake and the fault slips, there is a stress redistribution around it that induces more seismicity in some regions and inhibits in other regions. And finally, we have seen these slip-driven pore pressure changes that also affect the temporal evolution of the stability of the rock. So in general, the geomechanical analysis and a thorough monitoring that permits interpreting the induced seismicity in real time, so locating the earthquakes with good precision are necessary in order to manage the risk of inducing earthquakes below an acceptable level. So what we should do is a good characterization prior to an injection, and then do estimates of what we can expect from the injection that we want to do. And for this, we can use analytical solutions. We need to do a slip tendency analysis to identify which are the faults that are critically stressed. And in the case of Castor, the Amposta fault, which was bonding the reservoir, was already critically stressed. So this should set an alarm, because we may reactivate this fault, and actually it was reactivated. And also there was this deep fault that was also critically stressed, and this is what induces the larger earthquakes. We can also use analytical solutions like the one of Haixin Wu that allow us to estimate the stress changes along the fault for a given pressure change. And with this, we can do quick estimates of how our injection is going to affect the faults. And actually, when we start injecting, we should see if the seismicity is behaving as expected or not. If it's behaving as expected, it supposes that we have done a good characterization and we are understanding the system. But if it's not, this should set an alarm and suggest that we should stop injecting to try to understand what's happening that we are not understanding. And once we understand and can explain the seismicity, because we identify new features, then go ahead and continue if we see that the injection is safe. So just as a summary, we have seen that gas injection accelerated the movement of the Amposta fault, which was already critically stressed. So during the injection, the pore pressure increases while destabilizing the fault. But also after the stop of injection, we had a permanent destabilization of the Amposta fault, which was induced by the buoyancy of the gas that exerts this vertical force and destabilizes this part of the Amposta fault. So this slow seismic slip of the Amposta fault causes the movement of another deep fault. which produced the largest earthquake. So this deep pore was placed in the crystalline basement, which are stiff rocks that when they fail, they do it in a brittle way and they release a lot of energy. So thank you for your attention and I'm happy to answer questions.
Okay, thank you very much. I don't know, are there any questions from the audience or the online audience? I have one question. It is a little bit on you mentioned that there was some cooling.
Well, in Castor, the cooling was relatively small because the injection just lasted during 15 days. And the volume that was injected was not enough to induce a large cooling. But when we inject during years, like in a geothermal project, for instance, or in CO2 storage, after several years, let's say 10, 20 years, the volume of rock that would be cooled down becomes large, the radius of the cooling can be of hundreds of meters, and this may eventually induce seismicity of distant faults.
But this cooling, I mean, where does it come from? Is it the injected gas that is...
Yes. So usually the fluids, they don't equilibrate with the geothermal gradient along the wellbore. Initially, yes, during a few hours, but as the, so imagine we inject at 20 degrees or the same temperature as in the surface. This fluid is injected, if we inject a high flow rate, as it was injected in Castor, the fluid doesn't have time to thermally equilibrate with the surrounding. It's an adiabatic process. So within the well,
more. It would be a few degrees.
So probably the gas was injected, it was reaching the surf, the reservoir maybe at 60 or 80 degrees, or even maybe in this case 1.7. It could reach at 40 degrees, the reservoir was at 80, so there is a cooling of But the thing is that to have a significant effect on the stability of the subsurface, you need to inject during quite a lot of time because in days probably you can only cool down some meters around the well, but this has a relatively small effect on the geomechanical response.
Okay, thank you. Some other questions? Other questions?
Yes. Thank you, Victor, for your presentation. I have two questions. The first question is...
Maybe you can just show your face and stand here. Yes, please.
I don't see it. It's necessary.
It's better, I think. Well, okay. If you don't want to...
Where?
Are
here?
Yeah, that's okay.
Hello. Victor, I have two questions. The first question is, I don't know how do you model gas storage reservoir with porosity. I think the porosity is 1. The gas storage reservoir.
There are a lot of gas storage that they do it in salt caverns. So they find a rock of salt, they inject water and they dissolve the salt and they make a cavity and then they inject the gas. But in this case was an aquifer. This was a saline aquifer. In a karstic reservoir, so there are some conduits and some cavities, but it's rock. So the porosity it depends a lot depending on the castification, but the porosity could be around 10% or 20%. So it's actually porous media.
I mean, I doubt the flow in the cavity follows the Darcy's law.
No, no, but this is not a cavity. This is an aquifer.
Ah, it's an aquifer.
Yes.
But normally for the gas storage, it's just an empty cavity.
Yeah. There are many places in which it is like this, but not here.
I think this is an aquifer, although it's a karstic aquifer. It's so there are fractures, little fractures, let's say, and so it's not a cave or something. You can apply, I think, Darcy's law, or you apply Darcy's law.
We apply Darcy's law. Yeah.
Okay. Another question is. You just mentioned several geomechanical mechanisms, right? Causing the fault destabilization, build-up, buoyancy, and etc. I don't know how do you identify these different mechanisms.
In this case was quite challenging because as I was saying, the seismicity was very deep and it was a little bit difficult to explain, but so in general we know that when we inject a fluid in the subsurface and there are pore pressure changes, the stresses also change in response to these pore pressure changes, and then there is more and more knowledge on a seismic slip. So this is something that it's taken into account every time more and more. Regarding the shear stress transfer, it's also, it was well known for natural seismicity. And in cases of induced seismicity, it has been seen that it's also relevant in several cases. So it's also, It's something that it's well known that this phenomenon happens when there is a slip of the fault. It affects the stability of nearby faults. So since the pore pressure was very low, we thought that shear stress transfer was probably the main reason of the sequence to occur. Of course, there was the question of what was inducing this sequence, and we found that it was the imposta fault that was slipping aseismically.
Do you know which mechanism dominant in which stage?
So initially, buoyancy was acting all the time as we inject more and more gas. The buoyancy fault increases. So initially, probably pore pressure was having a larger effect, but you remember at the beginning, the number of microseismic events during the first days was very low. So pore pressure was probably having a low effect. And as the volume of gas was increasing, buoyancy started to have more weight and started destabilizing the fault. Then the accumulation of a seismic slip was the triggering of the deep fault, and then it was a sequence of just the shear stress transfer.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Somebody else wants to say something? Also from the online audience, you can also participate. Okay. If not, then I close the seminar, and I thank Victor for his presentation. Mm-hmm. And.